Whether you're looking for answers to specific life questions or seeking to become the best version of you possible, welcome to the Mental Breakdown and Psych Reg podcast, where we offer insight, information, and strategies based upon research and years of practice as clinical psychologists. So sit back, have a listen, and get connected with our hosts, Dr. Bernie Wilkinson and Dr. Richard Marshall. Welcome back. Richard, I'm excited what we're going to talk about today because on last Friday, I did a session on every other Friday or so. I have the opportunity to work and do some sports psychology work our local football club. Yeah.
See, and I'm learning. Footballers.
Eventually, you will get there.
Which is not to be confused with football players.
Correct. That's a good job. That's great.
How many months did that take?
I'm not going to talk about that learning curve. Okay. But I had the opportunity to work with some players and a couple teams. And in that session, we were talking about the importance of breathing.
Right.
And then lo and behold, this article comes out.
This article pops up about
how important breathing is.
That's right. I should do that with a tennis player, shouldn't I?
You should.
Oh my gosh.
I told them, I said, why is it important to breathe?
And there was stunned silence.
The puzzled look of 13-year-olds. Right. So we were talking about the importance of taking deep breaths, and then we found this article from NPR.
This is a wonderful little article.
Yeah.
I really enjoyed reading it and thinking about the implications of this research.
Yes, yes. So in this study, the title of the article is "A Tiny Spot in Mouse Brains May Explain How Breathing Calms the Mind."
Right.
And what's fascinating, and I do this with patients, and I'm sure that you do as well, we work on breathing techniques, especially when anxiety is an issue.
Right.
You know, as soon as you start feeling anxious, you want to start to focus on your breathing.
That's right.
Focus on making sure that you're taking nice deep breaths as opposed to those shallow hyperventilating breaths that we sometimes take. But this is some research that's starting to show perhaps why that's effective.
Right. We all know that there's some relationship between deep breathing and relaxing.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. We see it in Lamaze classes, and we see it in yoga, and we see it in therapy for anxiety and depression, hyper-aroused states. And so we know there's some connection.
Mm-hmm.
What's fascinating about this article is that it seeks to explain the mechanism by which that occurs.
Yeah.
Do you remember Hans Selye? He was the guy who created the word stress.
Okay, no.
All right. And it was quite by accident, this whole word stress. He did an experiment, and he expected to find one thing, but what he found out in the end was what they were doing was stressing these mice. It wasn't that they were changing their chemistry in trying to collect them and get them into cages. They were stressing them, and that's where he got the term stress.
Okay.
He borrowed it from engineering, the stress of materials, and finally you can stress them and finally you break them.
Okay.
But that experiment, the whole experiment about stress, was an accident. Mm-hmm. This one was too.
Yeah.
That's what I liked about it. It was really clever the way they did. It was really ingenious the way they did the experiment.
We'll talk a little bit about that.
You want me to talk?
Yeah, why not?
Because it's too
hard. Put you under stress.
I'm under stress. So I have to do deep breathing. Now, what they wanted to do was they wanted to figure out what part of the brain controls this breathing mechanism.
Right.
Okay. So we know there's a connection. So what part connects it? And so they knew that there's a cluster of about 3,000 neurons deep down in our brain that controls our breathing.
Right.
You breathe when you're asleep.
Mm-hmm.
So there's some other part of your brain that's controlling breathing.
Right.
Okay.
Sort of an automatic thing.
Right. It's automatic breathing. So that's deep down in the brainstem. Brainstem connects your brain to your spinal cord. And all those neurons are in there. Well, what they did is, they identified 175 of these 3,000 and said, we're going to knock those out and see what happens. And they expected that the breathing patterns would change.
Mm-hmm.
What they found instead is that the mice got really calm and didn't do anything. Instead of running around the cages, sniffing and exploring and everything like mice do, these mice just were chilled. They were chilled out. They didn't do anything. They were just calm and very slow breathing. And what they discovered was that in taking out these genes, or taking out these neurons, what those neurons do is they connect the breathing parts of the brain with the arousal parts of the brain.
Right.
So these mice weren't getting aroused.
Right.
And what they theorized was not only does arousal affect your breathing, but it's a two-way street.
Right. Your breathing.
Breathing can affect your arousal.
Right.
So now this is in mice, but the mechanisms are the same in mice and humans. So now they're going to start this research in humans to see if they can find the same things.
Well, they're not going to zap 175 of your neurons, but what they're going
to... With diphtheria. They use the diphtheria virus to knock out... So we're not going to inject diphtheria virus into humans, but there are ways to deaden those, to quiet those cells.
Right, right. So, yeah, so it's really important research because, as you said, it's... identifying this two-way street.
That's what's fascinating.
Because we've talked about that before, that, you know, many times our behaviors elicit emotions.
Right.
So what happens is, and one of the things that we do in therapy, is we work to help people identify, or more correctly, identify how they feel.
Right. That's right.
Because when we think about stress, anxiety, we... understand, if you really like sat back and thought about it, the way that you feel for excitement and the way that you feel for anxious or nervous or stressed, they're pretty similar physiologically.
Right, right.
The context is different, you know?
Right.
Mm-hmm. You're really excited about going on a roller coaster. Those feelings or those sensations that you're feeling in your body are very similar oftentimes to what you feel when you're nervous about doing something. And so when you... If you don't correctly identify these things, or if you don't correctly differentiate between these two, then you know that's when we begin to get anxious about something that we should be excited about.
And that's the important first step. And we see it over and over again, that people will come in and say, well, I'm frustrated. Mm-hmm. Frustrated doesn't identify an emotion. It's a subjective feeling that you have, but it doesn't identify it. And so the first step is, let's very carefully identify the emotion that you feel. Is it anger? Is it fear? Is it anxiety? Because until you identify the right emotion, you're not sure what to do about it.
Right, right. So one of the things that I talk about with patients and one of the exercises that I give them, if you feel yourself starting to get stressed, I use this kind of breathing stuff. And again, this is great that they're doing this research because it's going to really add some support to the idea. And maybe we'll get into some more research for the application of this.
Yeah, there are a great many flaws, I mean, possible flaws in their research.
Oh, absolutely.
I mean, how do you say that a mouse is calm versus, you know? Mm-hmm. So there are a number of questions, but yet there's so much that we know about this connection. Mm-hmm. And to think of this as a two-way street, there's this word, Indian word. Is this pranayama? That's the yoga that is... that controls breathing. Mm-hmm. And I don't think I've ever heard the word said. I've seen it written. Mm-hmm. But I think it's pronounced pranayama. And it is the practice in yoga to regulate your breathing. Mm-hmm. And these guys... So we know this has been around for thousands of years, this connection.
Right.
As you say, the fascinating thing is that it's a two-way street.
Mm-hmm.
That arousal affects breathing.
Right.
Because when we get aroused, we tend to breathe in a very shallow way.
Right, right.
And so we know that if we breathe deeply, it will relax us. So that's the important thing about this. And in fact, they call these 175 neurons the pranayama pathway,
right.
You know, which is really cool.
I remember...
This is a great contribution.
I remember when I was a kid, I don't remember how old I was, but I was watching a movie... Because that's what I did.
That's what you do. You still do.
Sometimes. But I was watching a movie. And again, I don't really remember what movie it was. But I know that it was some kind of action movie or something. And they were out in the snow or something. And this person was trying to get away. She was trying to get... she was an athlete. She was a runner. And she was trying to get away from some guy who wanted to kill her or something. I don't know. I don't remember. That's my memory of it. But I remember that she ended up getting like a flesh wound from a shot or something like that. And as she's running, you know, she's trying to get away. I remember her trying to hide, and she was bleeding, and she sat there and she talked about controlling her breathing so that she could slow her heart down so that she would stop panicking. And I think about that often when I am working with patients. I don't tell them the story of the movie, but I think about that, you know, as athletes, we oftentimes learn how to control our breathing, how to control our biological systems. We can slow our heart rate down a little bit so that we can remain calm.
Right.
You know, marksmen, you know really well how to use their heart rate or heartbeat as a tempo for when to pull the trigger or release the bowstring or whatever the case may be. So we know that there's this relationship between calmness and our biological systems. Mm-hmm. And so again, this research is really going to contribute to that. So, you know, again, one of the recommendations I have, because I think that this is a really neat activity, and I would encourage you, if you're listening to this, to try it. If you take a deep breath and you breathe in as much as you can, you know, breathe in and kind of hold it in, and as you get to the top of as you feel like you're at the apex, hold it there for a second, and then just go one more gasp of breath. And you can feel the top areas of your lungs fill with air, and you can almost feel a sensation of relaxation.
Right.
Almost any time you do it, even if you're not even really anxious or worked up or anything.
Yeah, when you're told to take a deep breath, most of us will take a mediocre deep breath.
Right.
You know, you really have to do what you just said. You think it's full. Take one more.
Right.
Okay.
And
that's when you begin to feel the calming effect of a deep breath.
Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And if you do that whole process slowly and do it four or five times.
Take it in through your nose. Mm-hmm. Right.
And then just that extra little at the end, you will feel a difference. And so whenever you're getting anxious or whenever you feel like you're getting worked up or overwhelmed with information or situation, you know, do that. Practice that several times, and you will feel yourself starting to relax.
That's right, because you're doing two things. One is controlled breathing also takes effortful concentration.
Right.
And so if you're thinking about that, you're no longer thinking about whatever's causing you anxiety. We realize that we're only talking about a few seconds.
Right.
But still, you relieve your brain of that stress.
Right.
The second thing, that when you begin to become anxious, aroused, stressed, you do begin to do shallow breathing.
Right.
Whether you know it or not.
Right.
Your breathing gets very shallow. When your breathing gets shallow, you're getting a buildup of carbon dioxide.
Right.
And you're not getting enough oxygen to your brain. So what that other breath does is it reoxygenates brain that's losing some of the oxygen that it needs. So there are a couple of mechanisms of action here that are served by taking even a single deep breath.
Right.
And if you can go a little beyond that to regulate your breathing, you're going to realize all kinds of benefits.
Yeah. So. Yeah. I use that oftentimes when I'm running. So if you're a runner, it's about whenever I get about a half mile in, I can take that kind of deep breath.
Right.
You know, initially you're breathing quickly and everything, but about a half mile in, once you can take that first deep breath and really fill
and
your lungs up, then everything
you
know, kind of calms and gets going. So, so give that a try.
And you tennis players out there, you high school tennis players, you're going to be facing county. Tournament starts this week in Polk County. Do these do these between serves, between matches, between sets, between games. Calm yourself down, but get more oxygen into your lungs and into your brain.
Absolutely.
It'll serve you well.
Absolutely. So, all right.
So, interesting article.
Yes. I'll have the link to it.
We posted it somewhere.
In the show notes. So, if you want to check it out, it'll be great. So, all right. Well,
enjoy
that's it.
Do it.
Until next time, stay happy, stay healthy, and forget to be afraid.